Bom dia. Bem-vindos ao Caminho da Inovação 2020. É um evento promovido pela Águas do Tejo Atlântico e aberto a toda a comunidade científica, a todos os empreendedores, aos nossos parceiros municipais, universidades e profissionais do setor da água. Habitualmente recebíamos-vos fisicamente na nossa fábrica de água de Alcântara. Este ano temos a oportunidade de tornar este evento também digital, devido à pandemia que atravessamos, pelo que o evento será exclusivamente online e terá três partes. Hoje é a primeira, amanhã pelas 9h30 teremos o segundo painel de discussão e na quinta-feira, a partir das 17 horas, teremos a apresentação dos desafios da Água 2020 e os resultados do caminho para a inovação 2020, e depois o último painel, que é um painel comemorativo, um pouco mais, enfim, para podermos relaxar um pouco e conversar de uma forma um bocadinho menos institucional. Portanto, nestes dois painéis institucionais que hoje começa o primeiro, e sem mais delongas, poderei dizer que podem escolher a língua no vosso ecrã que querem ouvir, se é a apresentação em direto ou inglês ou português. Eu irei fazer esta primeira parte institucional em português e passarei a falar em inglês com os nossos três convidados. Sem mais delongas, vou passar então a palavra à Presidente do Conselho de Administração da Águas do Tejo Atlântico, Ana Silveira, para nos dar aqui as suas boas-vindas. Muito obrigado.
Bom dia a todos e bem-vindos à quarta edição do Caminho da Inovação. Este ano, a distância física é compensada pela proximidade digital, sinais dos tempos que atravessamos, mas também um sinal claro de que as sociedades sabem transformar desafios em oportunidades e inovar na forma e no meio, tendo sempre por base a partilha do conhecimento e o desenvolvimento das comunidades em que nos inserimos. Todos os dias, na Águas do Tejo Atlântico, uma das nossas principais motivações é responder às crescentes necessidades dos municípios da região em que servimos. Podemos assim afirmar que o caminho da Tejo Atlântico está em constante evolução. Este ano, vimos percorrendo um caminho que nos uniu e nos mostrou que a adversidade nos faz revelar o melhor de nós e nos torna ainda mais solidários. Poderíamos usar a pandemia para fazer um paralelo com a situação que se vive hoje no planeta. A linearidade da Terra tem proporcionado bem-estar a várias gerações, mas o nosso planeta encontra-se esgotado e reclama uma circularidade que lhe permita caminhar rumo à sustentabilidade. Ao operarmos um serviço essencial para a saúde pública e para o ambiente, estamos a contribuir para esse caminho. Mas todos temos de fazer mais. Todos temos de nos superar, inovar e encontrar soluções coletivas e abrangentes para desenvolver este novo paradigma, modelos de negócio que nos permitam combater as alterações climáticas e contribuir para a descarbonização da economia e da sociedade, designadamente através de medidas de eficiência hídrica e energética. Momentos como estes, sejam eles físicos ou digitais, permitem uma partilha de conhecimento inspiradora que nos aproxima e nos faz reforçar o compromisso com um futuro que une empresas aos seus trabalhadores, às instituições, às universidades, aos empreendedores e à sociedade para responder com qualidade e circularidade às urgências ambientais que vivemos. Como todos sabemos, a economia circular assenta na transição do modelo linear de produção de bens e serviços para um modelo circular onde os materiais são devolvidos ao ciclo produtivo através da política dos três R's: recuperar, reciclar e reutilizar. Ora, nada é mais circular do que a água. Hoje, ao ritmo do seu crescente uso e consumo, a circularidade é também uma oportunidade para adotarmos novos comportamentos alinhados com os Objetivos de Desenvolvimento Sustentável, com recurso à ampla tecnologia já existente e em plena segurança. A água tem um papel decisivo na edificação das cidades verdes, através de três caminhos, todos eles no âmbito da economia circular: o caminho da água, o caminho dos materiais e o caminho da energia. A recuperação de recursos coloca alguns desafios, tais como encontrar mercados dispostos a trabalhar com produtos recuperados, como alternativas para os produtos recém-extraídos ou recém-fabricados. Uma questão fundamental prende-se com a dimensão das unidades de recuperação de recursos, dado que para que seja economicamente vantajosa a sua adoção, estas unidades terão de oferecer, em particular à indústria e à agricultura, preços altamente competitivos. Existem ainda outras barreiras associadas a esta temática, tais como os desafios tecnológicos, a aceitação dos consumidores à utilização de recursos recuperados e ainda a produção legislativa que tem de acompanhar todos estes processos de mudança. A crescente consciencialização socioambiental exige que as cidades sustentáveis do segundo quarto do século XXI se foquem na eficiência hídrica, não apenas na qualidade do serviço prestado, mas também na resposta inovadora que se impõe para construir esta circularidade do recurso, deste recurso essencial. Neste sentido, há águas do Tejo Atlântico, seguindo as melhores práticas e estratégias no âmbito da economia circular, vem concebendo e implementando vários projetos em parcerias nacionais e internacionais que evidenciam o caminho gradual e irreversível para a edificação de cidades sustentáveis na região que abrangemos. Estamos convictos que, ao assegurar a prestação de um serviço essencial e inovador, respeitando a envolvente, a comunidade e o ambiente, garantimos uma maior eficiência no uso de recursos e contribuímos para a sustentabilidade futura. Com a participação e os contributos de todos os convidados neste webinar, incluindo o Sr. Ministro do Ambiente e da Ação Climática, o Sr. Vereador da Câmara Municipal de Lisboa e os vários especialistas na área da saúde, na área do ambiente, no setor da água em particular, ficaremos mais fortes e certamente mais aptos para alcançar este nosso desígnio. Em nome da Tejo Atlântico, a todos, muito obrigada. And now, please allow me a few words in English to welcome our international guests and thank them for making themselves available to share their views on these critical topics with us. As we will see in just a moment, we will have a lot to learn from their unparalleled know-how and expertise, and I am 100% confident that their generous contributions will be an inspiration to us all in accelerating our journey of innovation towards the sustainability of our cities and ultimately of our planet. On behalf of everyone at Tejo Atlântico, bem-vindos, that is, welcome, and thank you very much.
Muito obrigado, Ana, e já agora, neste ano em que Lisboa foi eleita a capital verde europeia, que muito honra todos os portugueses e todos os cidadãos, tenho o prazer, o grato prazer, de solicitar ao vereador Sá Fernandes algumas palavras para este caminho da inovação 2020.
Olá. Bom dia Ana Silveira, não sei se o Sr. Ministro está a ouvir, bom dia também ao Sr. Ministro e a todos. Muito obrigado pelo convite e é uma grande honra estar nestes caminhos da inovação por duas razões. Lisboa participa nesta empresa do Tejo Atlântico, é um dos seus sócios, vamos assim dizer, e depois por aquilo que o Marcos acabou de dizer. Lisboa ganhou, de facto, este galardão da Capital Verde Europeia 2020. É provavelmente o maior prémio que se pode dar a uma cidade em termos europeus e em termos ambientais. E, portanto, começámos este ano... nós ganhámos o prémio não por sermos os melhores do mundo, porque não somos, mas porque evoluímos e temos evoluído muito ao longo dos últimos anos e porque temos um compromisso para o futuro também bastante credível, embora ambicioso também. E começámos bem. Nós começámos este ano da Capital Verde com as personalidades mais importantes, desde o António Guterres, Secretário-Geral das Nações Unidas, o Vice-Comissário Europeu, o Timmermans, o Sr. Ministro do Ambiente, o Sr. Primeiro-Ministro, o Sr. Presidente da República. No fundo, com a ideia de que unidos e com um programa comum, nós podíamos avançar em passos largos para uma cidade mais sustentável e um mundo mais sustentável. E daí também ter aparecido na Comissão Europeia, o New Deal, e portanto estávamos com grande esperança. Começámos logo, no dia a seguir, com uma plantação de 20 mil árvores, para dar um sinal, como que o bom exemplo é, muitas vezes é melhor que palavras ou com um sermão, e tínhamos, portanto, um ano pela frente de grande, de queremos informar, de valorizar aquilo que se faz em Portugal e noutros sítios, mas aconteceu aquilo que nós todos sabemos, que se prende com a pandemia, que atravessa o mundo inteiro, que nos tem, de facto, gerado aqui várias complicações. Aproveitámos essa, todos, julgo eu, para escutarmos. Eu acho que a pandemia fez com que escutássemos melhor uns aos outros. Mas também um sentimento de resistência. Nós estamos a resistir sempre com esta ideia de que a unidade é superior que as partes. E acho que foi com este sentimento que nós reprogramámos a Capital Verde Europeia, e aqui com o contributo de todos, incluindo, obviamente, do Tejo Atlântico, até porque a água é uma das componentes onde Lisboa tem evoluído mais nos últimos anos e aquela onde tem mais compromisso para o futuro. Nós, de facto, nos últimos 12 anos diminuímos os consumos da água, investimos a cidade no seu conjunto, Tejo Atlântico, EPAL, Câmara, nas chamadas fábricas da água. Percebemos que o problema da água tem uma dupla face, por paradoxo que pareça, mas que todos conhecem. Temos o problema das inundações, portanto, chuva a mais, e temos o problema da chuva a menos, da escassez da água. E eu acho que Lisboa, em relação a essas duas matérias, evoluiu bastante nos últimos anos. Lembro-me que há 12 anos 100 mil casas despejavam diretamente o seu esgoto para o Tejo. Hoje isso não acontece, graças a uma obra importantíssima feita pelo Tejo Atlântico e com os seus parceiros, nomeadamente com a Câmara Municipal de Lisboa, e hoje já não acontece isso, o que permite que temos uma água do nosso rio, o grande rio Tejo, o estuário do Tejo, que hoje está mais limpo, e que temos a esperança de um compromisso no futuro, que daqui a uns 10 anos a gente possa nadar sem qualquer problema no Tejo. Esse é um compromisso, mas para lá temos que continuar a trabalhar como temos trabalhado. Outros compromissos era, ou outra das maneiras de trabalhar em relação à chuva e às inundações, é termos um grande plano de drenagem, que está neste momento em concurso público para ser executado nos próximos anos. Em relação ainda à escassez de água, talvez a medida mais emblemática, porque eu acho que é uma medida de futuro e que, no fundo, representa uma maneira, um outro olhar para a água, tem a ver com a rede de água, a reutilização da água. A Ana Silveira já falou da circularidade, da importância da circularidade, e aqui temos um excelente exemplo de economia circular, a água que vai para as etares, portanto, para o trabalho da Tejo Atlântico, de regressar à cidade com um tratamento adequado para lavagens e para rega. É evidente que nós todos estamos a apostar muito neste tipo de investimento, porque tem vários tipos de eficiência. Uma é porque não estamos a poupar água potável, estamos a utilizar um recurso, dando de facto a circularidade que há pouco referi, para estas duas tarefas essenciais, sendo que uma é essencial também para combater a onda de calor. Nós precisamos, provavelmente, ter mais regas ou mais lavagens de ruas, precisamente para refrescar mais a cidade, porque esse é outro fenómeno das alterações climáticas, as cidades vão ficar mais quentes, e, portanto, este é um mecanismo útil também para esse efeito. Mas, de facto, a grande vantagem da reutilização de água é reutilizar a água e não deitarmos, e, portanto, tem este efeito de economia circular. Era isto que este é o nosso compromisso, é um compromisso que está bem firmado. Nós conseguimos, também ainda antes da pandemia, juntar todas as grandes empresas da cidade, públicas e privadas, para um compromisso de poupança, para um compromisso de reutilização da água, para um compromisso também de melhor de energias limpas. E esse compromisso está assinado, está firmado, está exposto numa das grandes avenidas da cidade, junto de um grande corredor verde, uma infraestrutura verde, o corredor de Monsanto e da Praça de Espanha, que mostram precisamente isso. O envolvimento de todos, partindo do princípio que a unidade, de facto, é superior às partes, para irmos para um ambiente melhor. E outra das grandes inovações tem a ver com a energia. A energia que nós gastamos, quer na distribuição de água, portanto, a cargo de outra empresa pública, a EPAL, quer a cargo, aquilo que se gasta na energia que se utiliza para o tratamento e a distribuição da nova rede de águas residuais, está a ser feito neste momento um grande investimento, uns em concurso, outros já em obra, de que essa, a energia necessária para a distribuição destes dois canais de água seja feita com energia solar. O investimento está a ser feito pela EPAL e está a ser feito pelo Tejo Atlântico. E isso é uma parte muito importante desta maneira de olharmos para estes recursos, que de alguma maneira são inovadores, porque não conheço muitas cidades que tenham água reutilizada e que ao mesmo tempo tenham energia na sua distribuição para renovar. Outras matérias que temos que trabalhar, eu julgo que hoje, ou nestes dias, se irá discutir essa temática, que tem a ver com as lamas, tem a ver com o potencial de outras fontes de energia ligadas aos próprios, enfim, aos materiais, enfim, não queria utilizar a palavra materiais, quer dizer, mas ao próprio recurso que existem ou que passam pelas hectares, ou as fábricas de água, eu gosto de dizer mais esse nome, mas ainda me lembro do antigo. E, portanto, eu estou, em relação à água, muito, muito esperançado. Tenho a certeza que estamos no bom caminho e estou muito esperançado que no futuro próximo Lisboa possa ser um exemplo nestas matérias, quer na matéria da água que bebemos, quer na matéria da água que distribuímos, que tratamos, quer o modo como utilizamos a água. E claro, o Rio Tejo, porque o Rio Tejo precisa de estar mais limpo, e só uma maneira de estar mais limpo é a água, é que a água seja tratada, a água que chega ao rio seja tratada, e seja tratada da melhor maneira possível. Este pode parecer uma coisa muito fácil, mas não foi fácil. Nós tentamos cumprir, e a Tejo Atlântico aqui tem um contributo absolutamente excepcional, um grande contributo para percebermos qual era o tratamento necessário para podermos regar os jardins da cidade e lavar as ruas sem criarmos qualquer outro problema, nomeadamente de saúde. E, portanto, houve aqui uma grande interligação com a Direção-Geral de Saúde, exatamente, e com o Instituto Ricardo Jorge, mas também com outras entidades ambientais, para percebermos como é que conseguimos atingir este desígnio. Julgo que os estudos que foram feitos, as exigências que foram pedidas, o trabalho que foi desenvolvido, principalmente aqui, mais uma vez, o agradecimento à Tejo Atlântico, foram fundamentais para que isto possa correr bem. Portanto, era isto, no fundo, que durante a Capital Verde nós gostaríamos muito de valorizar. Este caminhos da inovação iam ter, a Câmara ia ter uma grande participação nesta apresentação. Infelizmente não podemos fazer, mas aqui estamos nós a dizer o caminho que estamos a fazer, a ter a esperança no futuro. Apesar disto, a pandemia atrasou algumas obras, alguns concursos, mas não atrasou a vontade, não atrasou não deixou ninguém para trás, nem estas ideias ficaram para trás. Pelo contrário, há uma necessidade de que elas vão para a frente, na medida do possível. Tivemos, de facto, aqui problemas com alguns concursos e provavelmente iremos ter com algumas obras, mas o sermos bastante assertivos no papel que queremos ter nesta matéria, acho que vamos chegar a um bom porto. É com um bom porto que eu acabo esta minha pequena intervenção, desejando as boas-vindas a todos, que estes caminhos de inovação corram da melhor maneira possível, sendo certos que a TES Atlântico e a Câmara Municipal de Lisboa, que são parceiros nesta matéria, irão continuar o seu trabalho, sempre com esta máxima, aliás, com duas máximas, aquela que eu tenho referido já por duas vezes e repito pela terceira vez: a unidade é sempre superior às partes, neste, quem procura atingir estes objetivos. E uma coisa que eu aprendi com a pandemia e que me, dentro desta desilusão, euforia que fui sentindo ao longo deste ano, com as várias coisas desmarcadas, com as várias iniciativas que não se puderam fazer, senti sempre que há uma máxima que me fez guiar e que continuo com ânimo e a acreditar naquilo que fazemos todos, que é: quem quer só o que pode, pode tudo o que quer. E eu acho que é isso que temos feito, é isso que a TES Atlântico tem feito. Não temos os pés bem assentos na terra, ou na água, neste caso, para fazermos aquilo mesmo que acreditamos e que achamos que é bom para a cidade, para Portugal, para a Europa e para o mundo. Acho que somos um bom exemplo neste caso, e, portanto, é esse o caminho que seguimos. Não há nada, para terminar, não há nada como informarmos bem, não há nada como valorizar, não temos vergonha nenhuma de valorizar aquilo bem que fazemos, mas também é muito importante procurarmos a participação. E daí estes encontros serem muito importantes. Nós estamos sempre a aprender com os outros, e, portanto, esta abertura de valorizarmos, obviamente, o que fazemos, mas procurarmos ouvirmos outros, sentirmos que é necessário esta troca de informação para melhorarmos os nossos próprios comportamentos. E, portanto, muito obrigado, um grande sucesso para os caminhos da inovação e felicidades para todos. E muito obrigado. E bom dia.
Muito obrigado, Sr. Vereador, e conto sempre com o contributo do Grupo Águas de Portugal, através da TES Atlântico e da EPAL, para engrandecer a nossa capital verde, que não será só este ano de 2020, mas será com certeza durante as próximas décadas e os próximos séculos, para a sustentabilidade também e o nosso bem-estar. Porque nos também é importante, e é com muita elevada estima que passa a apresentar o testemunho de Sua Excelência, Sr. Ministro do Ambiente e da Ação Climática, João Pedro Matos Fernandes, que nos deixou para o Caminho da Inovação 2020.
São caminhos de inovação aqueles que temos que trilhar para combater aquilo que já hoje nos acontece com as alterações climáticas. Temos mesmo que saber fazer diferente para o futuro. Não podemos, em face da urgência climática em que nos encontramos, acreditar que vamos resolver os problemas do passado com soluções do passado. Não. É mesmo com soluções inovadoras que nós vamos ser capazes de reduzir a nossa pegada ecológica e apostar na gestão circular dos recursos. A água é o melhor exemplo dessa mesma circularidade. Todos conhecemos desde meninos o que é o ciclo da água, todos conhecemos agora, vocês que são técnicos desta área, o que é o ciclo urbano da água. A água não existe só para nós, existe para todos os ecossistemas e assim tem que poder e ser gerida. De forma eficiente, porque a água que temos hoje à nossa disposição é a mesma que temos desde que a Terra é Terra, sabendo nós que uma parcela significativa dessa mesma água se degradou e não pode voltar a ser utilizada. Por isso, temos que saber ser inovadores, fazer diferente e juntar a água com a energia. Uma parte muito significativa da água que todos pagamos em nossa casa e, obviamente, também do esgoto que é tratado, tem a ver com o custo da energia. A energia que é utilizada em diversas fases do processo, desde a captação da água na nascente até ao seu destino final, depois de ser tratado. E apesar de Portugal se orgulhar, e deve mesmo orgulhar-se, de 57% da energia que utilizamos, perdão, da eletricidade que utilizamos, já ter como origem as fontes renováveis, temos que definitivamente abandonar os combustíveis fósseis em todo o processo que tem a ver com o ciclo urbano de água. As Águas de Portugal, e dentro das Águas de Portugal, a empresa Águas do Teste Atlântico, tem projetos muito inovadores e são o primeiro grande grupo da água no mundo que tem este objetivo de ser completamente neutro do ponto de vista carbónico no que há produção de energia de respeito já em 2030. Para isso, temos então que apostar na inovação. Temos que desenvolver processos, temos que conhecer a tecnologia, sabendo que a tecnologia não nos resolve os problemas todos. Os processos dentro das empresas, dentro da vossa empresa e das outras, são fundamentais para poder tirar partido dessas mesmas novas tecnologias. Essas novas tecnologias vão impactar nos nossos clientes, temos que saber dar informação. E vão ter que utilizar toda a comunidade científica de maneira a que possamos ter sempre, com certeza, as melhores soluções e mais eficientes. A palavra descoberta é uma palavra portuguesa. Quando foi usada no século XIV, século XV, era usada apenas referindo-se às novas descobertas geográficas. Se lembrarem, nessa altura, éramos todos, de facto, muito tementes àquilo que os Evangelhos nos tinham ensinado e, para todos os efeitos, tudo tinha sido descoberto quando foi criado por Deus. Por isso, as descobertas eram só, repito, descobertas geográficas. Esse verbo, o verbo descobrir, é um verbo que hoje existe em todas as línguas. E trata-se mesmo de descobrir, de encontrar novas soluções e de irmos a este verbo, que afinal é só português, para podermos fazer melhor no futuro. É isso que desejamos, esta capacidade de inovar, de descobrir, mas para aplicar na prática, para dessa forma podermos satisfazer melhor os nossos clientes, sermos mais eficientes as nossas empresas e com isso termos melhores resultados do ponto de vista também da eficiência e da eficácia ambiental. É esta a mensagem que vos deixo nesta quarta edição do Caminho de Inovação. Felicito quem a promoveu e desejo-vos um ótimo trabalho.
Muito obrigado, Sr. Ministro. Não poderíamos ter encerrado a parte institucional melhor e com estas palavras de alento e de futuro que o João Pedro Matos Fernandes nos deixa. Passamos então agora para o painel Cidades Sustentáveis. Eu farei a apresentação dos intervenientes em português e irei falar com todos eles em inglês. As regras são simples, são 10 minutos de apresentação e depois das apresentações faremos as sessões de perguntas sustentadas, nas perguntas que nos deixarem no chat do YouTube. Para isso têm que carregar no botão que é o logotipo do YouTube, que se encontra no canto inferior direito do ecrã, e abrem aí o chat e farão as perguntas em português ou em inglês. É indiferente, nós faremos a tradução sem mais demoras também, vou passar então à apresentação do primeiro panelista. Eu vou só fazer uma pequena introdução em inglês. Hello, our guests, distinguished speakers. I will now start the Sustainable Cities panel. And the first contribution will be from Xavier Romero Hidalgo, and I will present you in Portuguese, and after that you will do your presentation, and the Q&R will be in the end of the all the three speakers. Okay, so Xavier Romero Hidalgo é um biólogo. É técnico de ambiente da Câmara Municipal de Granollers, na Escócia, e gera o sistema de água não potável desta cidade. Esta rede de água não potável inclui uma rede para reutilização e conta também o Xavier com muita experiência em vários projetos europeus e programas de cooperação internacional e de conservação da natureza, como, por exemplo, o Interlace, o Life Alnus e o CEMIO WAS 2. So, Xavier, I think you can hear us and you can start your presentation about sustainable cities and your case study in Barcelona. Sorry, I said Scotland, but it's in Barcelona. So, Xavier, please.
Morning, everybody. Thank you very much for the invitation to this great webinar. It's a wonderful pleasure for the Granollers City Council to participate in and a great opportunity for us to show our reuse local project that I'm going to briefly present you. So let's start with a brief presentation of the city, Granollers. Next, please. Granollers is a medium-sized city located near Barcelona, only 30 kilometers away. And the Granollers City Council has always had a great concern about water issues, because we know that the water management has a great impact on societies, environments, and economy. This is even more important in geographical areas like Portugal or Spain, where we all suffer from frequent droughts. And in some dry regions, we also suffer a constant water scarcity. So with this scenario, water authorities from international to local need to implement actions, policies, programs to ensure the water security and prevent that populations live under water stress conditions. In the case that we suffer from water scarcity, one of the best options is to implement water reuse in our regions. From the role of municipalities, I think that municipalities need to take a leadership role to promote the water reuse and to be an example for others, maybe bigger administrations and also the private stakeholders, which could also implement the reuse in their activities. We have a great experience on European projects and also in some international cooperation program. And one of the outcomes that we have learned is that in case, in any reuse at local level, we need to go together with the recovery of biodiversity, the recovery of social use, and also the awareness and the education of citizens. Next. These three requirements were included in the COMPES process of recovery of a peri-urban area named Can Cabañas that is placed in the south of the municipality of Granollers. This restoration project started in 1999, and the first action that we developed was the creation of a system of constructed wetland that was a really innovative action, a nature-based solution that was really innovative for that time. And this wetland received the effluent waters from the wastewater treatment plant, and after a natural treatment for 30 to 50 days, water goes to a reclamation plant. This is a facility for give an extra and additional treatment with filtration and disinfection, according to the Spanish national law about water reuse. And finally, we provide with reclaimed water, reuse water, recycled water, the concept that you prefer. And so this kind of waters goes to the city in different municipal uses. After more than 20 years, the reuse at local level has delivered different benefits to Granollers City. The first one is the improvement of the water quality from the wastewater treatment plant that is mainly used for the environmental use of the river, but also made reclaimed water available for the urban uses, mainly for the irrigation of the green spaces and the cleaning of the streets. A second benefit is the creation of a new habitat for biodiversity, the wetland, that it helped to the improvement of the fluvial ecosystem. And for that reason, in 2006, the wetland, its pine forest, and also the nearby river were included in Natural 2000, the main European network for preservation of habitats and species. Next benefit related to social use was that with the creation of a new special point for social activities in this recovered peri-urban area, we also started a process of green infrastructure for the city. The initial water reuse project enabled developing more recovery processes in the river and also in the rural landscape. And finally, this provide us a recovery social corridor from the city center to this area, Can Cabañas, that nowadays we have more than 1,000 users a day. This is a high proportion because it is 60,000 inhabitants. So it's a great news for the whole project. We also hope for future benefits. One of them is in the near future because the two factories located next to the wetland are going to be relocated to another industrial estate before year 2022. And this is something approved by the Granollers Urban Plan. This is a great opportunity to increase the green area and also to create a second wetland for water reuse and also biodiversity. Another future goals that we have are bring the reused water for private destinations. The agricultural sector is particularly interested in this kind of water, especially when they think in the shortage of underground water expected according to our climate change reports. Right now, we're developing a pilot project about irrigation of crops with reclaimed water with the support of the Interreg Themowas 2 project. And we also have in this project two Portuguese partners, Universidade Nova of Lisboa, and also the Agencia Lisboa Innova. On the other hand, the reuse water for industry is an ambitious long-term project. We will need the cooperation of a supra-municipal organization to implement it, but we are really optimistic because after the first preliminary feasibility reports, there are a couple of big enterprises that were really interested in this kind of initiative. Besides, the Catalan Water Agency, it's also thinking about preparing some subsidy for this kind of actions. As you just already noticed, this is a big hydraulic infrastructure for the city with 10 kilometers and 7 more are expected in the future. And the network, this is a second water network for us, consists of a wastewater treatment plant, the reclamation plant, several storage tanks and pumping stations, and also the system of drip irrigation in the green areas. Everything is under control of a remote management system that we have in the offices of the City Council. To finish, one recommendation, conclusion, it's that this water reuse at local level accept the challenge to change the current water model that traditionally is only water treatment plus discharge. And now we are introducing a new step, the water reuse, to complete and close the local water cycle. This kind of strategy need to be together with a multidisciplinary project, like the one that we put into practice in Granollers, activating a peri-urban area, and finally providing more sustainability to the city. Because what it started like a specific water reuse project, it finishes providing several recreational services, ecosystemic services, and we hope that maybe in future also a green economy for the city. This is all. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thank you, Xavier. Now, about your presentation of your city in Spain, it was very interesting for us that we are developing also several projects by water reuse, and your experience means a lot to us. And now we will go to Sandy Scott Roberts. I will speak in Portuguese just to present you, Sandy. Sorry. Sandy, gero em Orange County, na Califórnia, gero um programa de sistema de recarga de aquíferos. É licenciada e mestre em Engenharia Civil e do Ambiente pela Universidade Politécnica do Estado da Califórnia, São Luís Obispo. Tem vasta experiência em gestão de projetos de planeamento, de viabilidade, concessão e construção de instalações de tratamento de água. Atualmente é gestora de projeto de expansão final do sistema de recarga de aquíferos. A Sandy irá apresentar uma apresentação da Sandy vai ser sobre o tema a entidade gestora de água de Orange County e a maior estação de reutilização de água do mundo, o sistema de recarga de aquíferos na Califórnia, nos Estados Unidos da América. Sandy, the stage is yours, and please share with us your knowledge and your experience. Please.
Okay, I will do.
Thank you.
Everybody can hear me and see my presentation. So today I'm going to be presenting a look inside the Orange County Water District's groundwater replenishment system. It's the world's largest potable reuse facility, and it is located in Southern California in the United States. So I have an overall map of the state of California. And you can see Southern California there in blue and green. And what I'd like to point out with California is that most of the population in California lives in Southern California in the area of Los Angeles and Orange County. And in California, Southern California, we have an average rainfall of 300 millimeters a year. So not much. Our water supplies for Southern California come from two major sources. One is from groundwater, from underground groundwater. And the second source is from imported supplies. What you can see on that map is the yellow lines. There's the California Aqueduct and the Colorado River Aqueduct. Our water comes from faraway sources, hundreds of miles away, in pipelines, pump stations, reservoirs to bring water to Southern California, which is an expensive option for water. And so with that, we looked for other sources of local supplies of water that we could do. So the Orange County Water District, just to give you a little background, we service an area of Orange County. It's just south of Los Angeles County. We were formed in 1933. Our job is to manage the groundwater basin so it does not get depleted. We want to make sure that there's groundwater for all the cities in Orange County. We serve 2.5 million residents in the area, and we supply 77% of the water from groundwater. So we operate the groundwater replenishment system, or for short, GWRS. Just to give you some main points about it, it produces 378 million liters per day of purified water that we actually put back into the ground for drinking water. And cities pump the water from our groundwater basin to serve to their residents. This facility purifies sewer water, or and it goes through wastewater treatment, of course, and then the GWRS facility. And this is sewer water that would have otherwise been discharged to the ocean. Like I said, we produce a drinking water quality, and the amount of water we replenish with the facility alone is enough for 850,000 people for 1 year. So we've been operational since January 2008, and it is the largest potable reuse project in the world, slightly different than reclaimable water. We use this one for drinking purposes. So our treatment technologies for producing this purified water at GWRS looks like this. So we have highly treated wastewater. The wastewater goes through primary, settling, secondary treatment, and then we receive it at the Orange County Water District. Our project partners is the Orange County Sanitation District, so they treat the wastewater. We then take it and run it through microfiltration, so to make it tertiary. There's a backwash that's produced, which we send back to the Orange Sanitation District. And then this is the step that makes us a little different than reclaimed water, is we send the water through reverse osmosis. And then there's a brine that's left behind that we also send back to the Orange County Sanitation District. After reverse osmosis, the water is very pure. We then run it through ultraviolet light with hydrogen peroxide, and then we take that water and we run it into injection wells and recharge basins. And this is just lakes that we use to fill up our water and recharge it back into the groundwater basin, or inject it through injection wells. Here's a map of our facility. We're located in Fountain Valley, California. You can kind of get an idea of the scope of the project. We've got our microfiltration, ultrafiltration building, our RO building, UV. We have equalization tanks, and we have a post-treatment system, which I'm going to talk about, where we add lime back into the water because it is so pure. Here's a picture of our microfilters, just one rack. These are polypropylene hollow fiber microfilters provided by DuPont, or formerly Evoqua. We use these at the GWRS to pre-treat the water. Here's a picture of our reverse osmosis elements at the facility, or our pressure vessels. The reverse osmosis, the purpose is really to treat water at a molecular level, the dissolved solids, salts, organics, anything that's in the water. Large molecules are all removed through the membranes of the reverse osmosis. After the reverse osmosis, we send the water through ultraviolet light. This disinfects the water as well as removes any small organics that may have made it through the reverse osmosis process. And finally, like I mentioned, the water is actually, after reverse osmosis, is so pure with dissolved solids near zero. We actually add minerals back in so that the water won't corrode concrete. And so what we add is calcium hydroxide. We make a calcium hydroxide solution and add that calcium back into the water. So we mineralize it and raise the pH so that it's a drinking water quality. Just a little bit about the project. We get this question a lot. The GWRS project, it originally cost $481 million to build, and that was in the year 2003 when that price was fixed. We split the project cost between the Orange County Sanitation District and ourselves, so it was a 50-50 split. We received state and federal grants, $92 million, and also some grants from the imported water suppliers who benefited from us having a local supply of this water. We expanded the facility for an additional $142 million. And although these seem like big numbers, these costs are still less, and they're comparable to the imported water rates that are charged to Southern Californians to get water from the faraway sources. So why did we need GWRS? Well, Southern California has had reoccurring and extended droughts. There's also water shortages from those imported sources from Northern California, from the Colorado River. Those sources of water aren't always available. And so it's important that there's a local project, a local way that the residents in Southern California can depend on water. And by replenishing our groundwater basin and continuously keeping it full, it alleviates that problem. We also, in keeping the groundwater full with the GWRS facility, we also help to combat seawater intrusion when seawater starts to try to get into groundwater levels that have risen too low. So what have we learned from putting this facility online? Public perception is a big deal. You got to make sure that the public accepts the sewer water that's treated to drinking water standards. But we have learned that the public can accept these kinds of projects if there's a clear need, if outreach is effective, such as this, when we tell others about what we're doing and what we have learned. We make sure that the water quality is very high water quality. Elected officials, community leaders are also on board, and we have the regulations, we have the permits to operate the facility, and we even have an independent scientific review that reviews our operations as well as how we originally built the facility. So our thought is the more people know about it, the more they accept it. GWRS has also had lots of success. This is part of our public outreach campaign. We've received numerous awards and media attention. We allow visitors to visit our facility from all over. And so once the COVID restrictions are lifted, and anyone listening here is interested in Southern California, the tours are free and you can sign up, and we allow anyone from the public to come and tour our facility and see what we do. That concludes my presentation about Orange County Water District and the GWRS facility and how we've been working to try to make our area in Orange County more sustainable by recycling our wastewater and continuously using it as well for drinking water. And I guess I'd be happy to answer any questions during the question and answer phase. Thank you.
Thank you, Sandy. I will appoint a tour when I will be in your country. thank you for sharing with us your experience in this world dimension and huge project, water treatment in drinking water quality. It is very important for us to know that it's possible, it's it's done, so we can do it if we need it. For now, we don't need it to do in Portugal, but we can use it for other urban uses. Now, the third speaker, I will present him, Graham Coakley, in Portuguese. Graham Coakley tem uma apresentação que, para este caminho da inovação 2020, para procurar o estabelecimento de um ambiente facilitador que estimule a inovação urbana. Graham Coakley conviveu com várias culturas e trabalhou em todos os continentes, através da Shell, Gemini Consulting, Capgemini, e esteve envolvido na transformação destas grandes empresas. Posteriormente, dedicou-se ao interesse público das grandes cidades e é responsável executivo das atividades do grupo na Comissão Europeia. O grupo é o VP Global. Atualmente, enquanto parceiro fundador da Urban DNA, Graham e a sua equipa procuram promover globalmente a transformação das cidades e resolver as questões mais críticas do ambiente urbano. Espero que com a sua apresentação contribua também para a gestão, para conhecermos melhor as possibilidades de uma gestão eficiente no setor da água. So, Graham, welcome to Portugal, well, online Portugal, and we will expecting a lot from your presentation, so when you want, you can start, please.
Marcos, thanks very much indeed. And it's a pleasure to interact with Portugal, having been involved with two projects, particularly with Lisbon. It's been a great pleasure to work with the city. And it's also interesting with Barcelona. So I'll be picking up some of the experience we've had from the Rescue Project, which is an urban resilience project focused on climate change and water, which has involved Lisbon and Barcelona and Bristol in the UK. I guess the story moves from one of water scarcity to water abundance, which as a Scotsman, I'm very familiar with. I'd actually like to focus on the first word on that slide, which is innovation and innovation pathways, rather than necessarily focus on water. Typically, it's not a lack of ideas or a lack of skills which actually inhibits us to move forward. It's more about the contextual surroundings. And it was interesting listening to Xavier and Sandy in terms of the story they were telling. If you stepped back from that, you heard a number of really important things. The first was some really sophisticated technologies, a variety of sophisticated technologies, particularly from Sandy's story. And from Xavier, indeed from both, you heard the need for municipalities to role model. You heard the need for society to be built into how things are going to work, how policies, how laws, and how circularity all moves. Water is either scarce or highly abundant, and we're really moving on from that. So I'd like to explore two hypotheses, if you could move down one. The first is that innovation doesn't occur by chance. It actually requires nurturing. And the second is that in many ways, water systems are no different really from many other city systems if you actually want to stimulate innovation. Now, just water system itself is a system of systems. And when you step back from the water system only and look at a city as a system of systems, it becomes that much more complicated. Water is one of the city lifelines, so therefore it's absolutely vital that we have it going. But if you look at the blue area, there are a number of other city silos, if you like, that are absolutely vital for the water system to interface with. And clearly with COVID on at the moment, health is one of those. So you have a variety of infrastructure, a variety of providers, both inside and outside of City Hall, that all interact in terms of infrastructure and service and people to deliver what is a deeply interdependent system. Running across those are two now more important aspects. One is digitization and how digital and data can really change the way that systems are used. We use digital for efficiency. That efficiency is good. However, the downside of that is it creates a deeper interdependence. And if one of those systems falls over, as has been reinforced by the Rescue Resilience Project, you have the cascading, the domino effect, in terms of services going down, which therefore means that the more general enablers in terms of how we engage with society, how we lead cities, how we do planning, how we steward our assets is absolutely vital. So turning from that complex environment to the next slide, where we can actually look at innovation. So a few years ago, I was asked to address the topic of innovation in India for a number of cities, one of which was a massive investment of 7 billion to actually build a new capital city. And they sought for every single city system to be different. And that required approaching innovation across water and other systems in a completely different way. So we developed a framework to actually try and help the city to approach innovation. That's been tested in various other cities in the developed world as well. it consists of four pillars. The first and last in terms of framework conditions, that's about ensuring that the cascade from national or international policy and regulations come through the various different tiers of government and actually are contextualized within the city and the regulatory environment within the city. The other end of the spectrum in terms of sustaining value is ensuring that you have the necessary business models, financing mechanisms, performance management to actually make the system work. So those two are the bookends of what actually happens in between. Now, given the point about all the city systems being highly interdependent, it's really important that we have collaboration. So the network enabling defects poses the question of how best to bring together the people, society, academia, the business community, municipalities, to actually understand the basket of services and how you use that in a digital environment to work. So that network enabling aspect is key. And then the crucible for innovation itself is where you actually do the work. In cities, you typically find that those are isolated islands. Very few cities have actually pooled their, shall we say, innovation hubs together to really understand how the people, the process, and the technology work together. Moving down, the important point is this can be measured and assessed, and it is different. There are half a dozen cities that are posted there in terms of looking at those four pillars. The interesting point is that those two bookends are typically viewed as being not as advanced as they should be in some quite progressive cities. So moving to the last slide, one of the things which is absolutely vital is seven steps here, everything requires seven steps to heaven. But what I'd like to focus on is one really important aspect, which is that of horizon scanning. Horizon scanning is important in all city infrastructures and is really the case of rather than moving forward from today, to actually step back and say, what is occurring on the horizon? What are we seeing out there on the horizon? And taking very positive action to grasp it and pull it towards the city. That's a choice that a city makes in terms of what is most important for them. And in the area of city systems, it's not just about the conventional technologies. It is also these days very much about how data and digitization will actually draw that into the city system. So the focus that I really have placed on you is not our inability to innovate in terms of ideas and skills and people, it's actually our ability to work systemically, to work in a collaborative environment and really understand how we can approach innovation in a systemic and joined up way. So I leave you with those thoughts. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Graham. And well, behind the water systems, there are several interfaces, and every interface goes to innovation and the need to work together to can build the innovation system and the water system. Okay, so we will start the question. The Q&A part. I have several questions. I will start with Xavier, please. I have here a question about the receptivity of the population regarding the use of recycling water. You work about it in to increase the acceptance levels of the population to the recycling water receptivity. You work with communication or marketing plan or something.
Yes, we have implemented some environmental education programs about explaining our water reuse. And the main thing is to change the citizens' view that reused water is using directly the black waters for the irrigations, for instance. We spend something different with a concept that we call naturalization. And it is that we have a multi-barrier system, so it's a safe water, but that we take the water from the wetland. So it's a natural habitat that provides us the reclaimed water. It's not from the black waters. So with this naturalization, it's easy for the citizens to understand that this is a whole recovery process, and the waters that we use in the city provide from a natural area, not directly from the gray waters or green waters, black waters, sorry. This is more or less our explanation. And I have to recognize that the Granollers citizens have a good acceptance of the reclaimed water. It's a long time that we are using, and there is no problem at all in any green part in any use.
I'm glad to hear that, because we are now doing the first steps our irrigation system here in a part of Lisbon, and we are trying to implement also the education plan to helping us to implement the system. Sandy, you present all the benefits of the project, but in the beginning, there are other impacts that you try to mitigate, and you succeed, of course, but what were the worst part of that implementing system?
Okay, so for the implementation of the GWS facility, I guess the biggest hurdles was to get it permitted through regulators, and that was a big hurdle. We worked for many years with regulators and scientists, and I guess in point to some of the presentations today, it first took innovation and that thought, let's do this. This would provide a local supply to Southern California. It could cost less, so we're going to do this, even though there were many hurdles. So regulation-wise was number one. Money-wise, it was going to be an expensive project. However, all the models were showing that even though it's an expensive project, it still would have been, it's still more cost effective than our next source of water, which is the imported water from faraway sources. So those were some of the big hurdles. Public perception was, like I mentioned, a very big hurdle. There were other cities that tried to do similar projects. However, there was a political movement to stamp out drinking sewer water. And so it was a hurdle we had to overcome with lots of education, public outreach, tours, ensuring the public that they can trust their water. That we test it, we ensure it's safe, and we allow everyone to come visit it. I'd say those were really our biggest hurdles.
Okay. Sandy, I have here another question, just it's connecting with this one. So does Orange County promote water efficiency, like distribution network loss control, or use low consuming landscapes? Is there water, reuse on, this is the question.
Yes, we do. We actually, during times of drought in California, we have our biggest water use from the homeowners are for irrigation. We do live in a desert, but a lot of people in Southern California still have grass on their lawns, or have lawns, and so keeping those lawns green is a problem in a drought area. And so one of the biggest items is no watering of lawns during droughts, and you can't water during the daytime. There's actually many restrictions during drought times on water usage. And we must use water efficient washing machines in the home, as well as the shower faucets and nozzles and toilet flushing, and lawn replacement programs are being promoted in Orange County to remove the lawn and turn it more into a natural desert-like landscape.
Okay, thank you, Sandy. Graham, I have here a good question. What were the main challenges on implementing the four-pillar framework in the Indian city, and how you would adapt them for an existing city, for instance, in Europe?
Yeah, good. So we've actually done both. In India, it was about bringing people together. So it was about collecting together the representatives of place, which invariably is convened by public administration. So City Hall plays a vital role in that, but also bringing in a variety of different public bodies, academia, businesses, and importantly, particularly to Sandy's point, bringing in people that will actually represent society. Specific to India, the biggest blocker was actually mindset. They were driven by measures that came from Delhi in terms of national requirements and targets. But those targets would move the cities that were behind up to a level of acceptability. What I find fascinating is that they blocked innovation. And what we did in working with 8 different service areas is to try and cause people back to Horizon Scan to think about what was in the future and start to change their paradigms. And that fundamentally changed the way that they designed a lot of the city services. In Europe, I think the biggest issue is inertia. We overstated, we're fat and happy. You know, life is good-ish, particularly in the current environment. So there's not sufficient stimulus to really try and cause people to collaborate, to innovate. And I think that's the blocker that we have in Europe. I think we need to wake up to COVID, wake up to sustainability, and City Hall plays a key role to engage society, to actually cause people to want to do things differently and to see the advantage of doing so. And that I think is the biggest barrier in Europe.
Okay. Thank you, Graham. Back to Xavier. Well, we have here a question that asks you, what are the bottlenecks for private and industrial use of wastewater?
Okay, so, yes, okay. It's an easy question. Next is I think it's the investment. We need a lot of money to increase the hydraulic network, because now it's a good network for municipal uses. It's thing from the wetland area to the city, but it's different if we now need to invest more money for agriculture and industry. For industry, I think that we can achieve a price of reclaimed water that could be really interested for them, because we expect the water price is going to increase between 3 to 5 times in the next 5 years. So maybe they could help us to pay this inversion. But speaking about the agricultural sector, it's more difficult that they can help us, because they are really, really get used to pay 0 euros for water. So maybe this kind of projects only need to be developed if any public administration subsidy this kind of project. I think now could be seem like something really, really difficult, but maybe with the climate change in 20 to 30 years, maybe this is a need, Because if we don't have water, I'm sure that the peri-urban agriculture is going to disappear in our region. So maybe the matter is money.
So Xavier, in our days, the agriculture they pay the reclaimed water to use, or it's for free? Sorry.
Nowadays we only have a pilot project about irrigation with the reclaimed water in the agricultural lands of Granollers. But it's only a demonstrative project. It's not a real situation. So there is no reclamation for the agricultural reuse. But the thing is, the current use of water in the crops is everything from the underground water. So maybe for them it's only 0.2 euros, the price of the energy to get this water. So maybe it seems difficult that in a short term we can develop this kind of project. No, it's not a question of innovation, because there is enough water treatment to provide the quality for the irrigation with reclaimed water or the reclaimed water of crops. It's more that we don't have the current need to make a great investment to this kind of initiative.
Thank you. I understand that. Yes, thank you. Grant, about the priorities for innovation, do you think that the ecosystem services approach can help to setting the priorities and guide the definition of the priorities for innovation in local innovation, for instance?
Yeah, it's a good question. If I look to Bristol, which is one of the three cities within the Rescue Project, the need to bring the city service providers, some of which are external private companies, some of which are public 100% owned companies, and a variety of different city hall departments together, is absolutely vital to stimulate innovation. In fact, within Bristol, what the city has done is come up with a one city plan and a one city office. So they've actually structured how they go about things within City Hall in a very joined up way. They're taking down the silos. And importantly also, they're looking at societal engagement in a far more disciplined and managed sense. And also picking up one point that Xavier said, money. Business model innovation is going to be very important as we move forward, and incentivization to actually cause people to accept that water is not free. So we need to invest in different ways of doing things. So I think we'll need to work together within City Hall. B, we start to think about innovating in different ways, not technical innovation only, also in terms of how we engage society and how we pull together business models that work.
Thank you. The water, the value is very important to work, because the water value is something that we think it's almost for free, and we have many investments to do it, and it's important to work the concern of the population also about that. Sandy, we have here two questions. The first one: what were the main concerns of the healthy authority in recharging the aquifers? What were the main concerns?
So our authority is the Department of Public Health, and it's the Division of Drinking Water that oversee this permit. And their main concern is a log virus removal throughout all the treatment processes. So we have a 12 log virus removal. And one of the steps in that virus removal viruses are, at least from our experience and our research, are completely removed after reverse osmosis. However, the concern is if there was an integrity breach in a membrane and a virus went undetected, we still need a secondary way to protect the health. And so that's really what it's about, the groundwater recharge. The water is drinking water quality, and you can drink it from our treatment facility. However, to add that extra protection layer in case of an integrity breach, there's a 2-month travel time required for where the treated water hits the ground or is in the ground to a city's production well. So that's an additional requirement that was put on by the Department of Public Health for our facility.
You only produce drinking water quality, or you produce other qualities for other uses?
This facility only produces drinking water quality. We have another facility where we produce irrigation water, non-potable, but GWS drinking water quality only.
In your country, so in California, the value of the reused water for other uses are the same of drinking water, or a half, or what is the value of the reused water for non-drinking purposes?
Right. That value is high in Southern California. Like I said, there's a lot of places that use non-potable water for irrigation because we're in a desert, and people still like plants and life. So we do use the non-potable water for irrigation. As far as value, it's probably about half the cost as the cost for the drinking water. It is widely used by cities in Orange County for irrigation.
Thank you, Sandy. We are 3 minutes to the end. And just to finish, Graham, you said that in Europe, the innovation is not being stimulated because we are comfortable as we are. Do you have this feeling in equal ways from people in general, or just for the public services that, for instance, water that we provide?
That's a good question. I think we have, I think in Europe we have a perception, an attitude towards public services, which is that they should be there for us all the time. And I think that perception is important to change so that we actually value them more and get more engaged in them. So I think from the standpoint of a rather lackadaisical view around public services, yes, we need to stimulate that. If you compare that to innovation in the economy, in businesses and such like, that's variable too, but it's probably slightly more innovative because there's more pressure on it, and the pressure comes from shareholders and money. So yes, there is a difference between the sectors around their ability to innovate, but everybody needs to think about what matters, which is a quality life. And with COVID and with sustainability issues that sit there in the future, there's a wake-up call, which is very important. And the opportunity for innovation through that is enormous. We just need to figure out how to do it better.
Okay, so we will try that. So last question goes for Xavier. You provide different kinds of quality in the reuse water. Is the value of this water different from for each use, or is this similar? It's a similar question that I made to Sandy, but that's what our public wants to hear. Xavier, the value, you have only one quality and one price, or several prices?
Okay.
For right each now, use, industrial or agriculture? Agriculture is zero, but urban water use or
something. Let me explain that right now it's everything for the public use. So we produce the water, and we do the irrigation, the cleaning of streets. So everything is under the municipal control. So there is no price for this water. In case that we supply this water to agriculture and also to the industrial areas, it seems that maybe we can supply this water around 1 euro, maybe a little bit more per cubic meter. So this is going to be a price really attractive for these users, especially the industrial users, because maybe they are going to pay the water for around 5 euros in 5 years. But on the other hand, as I mentioned before, that it is needed a great investment, and this is not easy right now. So on the other hand, speaking about the quality of water, this is something related to the Spanish water reuse regulation. There are different kind of uses, and each use have a specific quality. The municipal uses, everything is under the same level, so it's the same quality. It's not really difficult to achieve this quality. And in the case of the agricultural quality level, it's a little bit more demanding. And finally, the industrial use level, it depends on the kind of industry. There are some industrial uses that are not really difficult to achieve this quality, but there are some of them that maybe there is a need of an extra treatment in the factory. But right now we don't have a fixed price for agriculture or industrial supply. Maybe in 5-10 years, if we do again this seminar, maybe I could inform you about these prices, but this is only preliminary information, and maybe it could change a lot in the future.
Okay, Xavier, thank you. See you in future. And last minute question just for Xavier, I think it's easy. What type of analytic program do you use in this project? Can you, if you don't know? If...
Yes, I know.
Okay.
We have a weekly monitoring of the wetland, the reclamation plan, and every point that we use the water. And this is compulsory according to the national legislation, and we do the physical and chemical parameters, and also the microbiology, including Legionella. And I suppose that with the pandemic, something it's going to change. It maybe soon it's going to add new parameters about public health, so maybe virus or something like that. But right now, the everything is under the 2006 Spanish national law about water reuse. And if you can check all the information, looking for the Spanish law about water reuse, everything is very specified there.
Okay, thank you for all, and thank you Xavier, thank you Sandy, thank you Graham. It was very comforting to have your experience here with us, I hope you enjoy it. I hope to see you here in Portugal, because I think Graham used to come here. But for you too, please come after this pandemic issue that we are crossing. And well, now we will hand this this panel, and wishing you all the best. And thank you. Thank you very much. Muito obrigado a todos os que estiveram connosco neste painel. Relembramos que amanhã às 9h30 teremos um painel dedicado às águas residuais em tempo de pandemia. Contamos convosco no caminho da Inovação 2020, esta quarta edição online, mas muito concorrida e muito, muito incentivada, vejo pelas perguntas que tivemos. Quero agradecer a todos os que participaram também e agradecer à equipa que colocou este caminho da inovação online e o tornou possível. Muito obrigado e até amanhã às 9h30.